You're listening to episode 69 featuring Brianna Salvatore Dueck.
When I got to college, I had had my third knee surgery. Actually, by the time I entered my super senior fifth year, I was three surgeries in. So I was a bit discouraged on the possibility of playing professionally just because I didn't know if my body could hold up or if it was the smart thing to do. But actually, when I got to the end of my senior year, I felt great. I was playing really well, and it just didn't feel like that was the time to be done. And so I was ready to go and shoot my shot to play professionally. Yeah, gotta aim for the top like, hello, yeah, I can never doubt myself, I know better, all of you critics be acting like you know better, blowing the smoke, but I know when the dust settles, so I'm in my element, it's evident that there's levels to the game.
So what's happening, people? Welcome back to the Athletes to Athletes podcast. And today I'm sitting down with Brianna. And Brianna, we had a chance to meet probably almost a year ago at an SBJ conference. And it was really cool to kind of run into you as we were kind of walking through the mixer area and get your card and connect. And it's been awesome to follow you on LinkedIn and see the things that you're able to do, hosting conferences and traveling. And, you know, you just said that you've been kind of all over the world lately, so it's good to be home. So I really appreciate that in your time of being home that you hop on here. So welcome to the show. Really appreciate it.
Thanks so much, Ryan. Yeah, really excited to be here and loved getting to connect back at SBJ. Excited for our conversation.
Yeah. So like I said, I like to kind of start things off with five rapid fire questions. And so the first one I have for you is, growing up as an athlete, who was an athlete for you that was kind of a role model that's the athlete that you emulated your game after?
Yeah, that's hard to pick one. I would probably say Magic Johnson, in that he was a really tall point guard. He was a great, incredible leader on the court. He also was an incredible leader in the community, and that's something that I really aspired to be as well. So being really just a great teammate, excellent at my sport, and then also I feel like he had a lot of fun on the court. Mm-hmm. Very joyful when he plays, and you could see a looseness about his game. So that's definitely someone that I really tried to emulate. And
So what made you fall in love with sports in general?
That's a great question. So for me, basketball, I started playing in the fifth grade. And I think the thing that made me fall in love with the sport was just this ability for basketball to serve as this connection point with my teammates, with my coaches, with my friends. It gave me confidence in myself. So I think it was really the connection and the community aspect of it that I really loved, and the competition as well. I'm very, very competitive. And so I think that was also something I fell in love with.
Yeah. So you went on to play in college. Who's an opponent that was just like really fun to play with, play against as like such a competitor that you were?
I loved our games against Stanford. So I played at UC Davis, and Stanford is just about an hour and a half away from UC Davis. But it was always really fun competitions because they're a similar type of, they played a similar type of basketball to us. It was a lot of like shooters on their team. But I think they were just like they were the more athletic version of UC Davis, but our coaches got along really well. And Coach Jen Gross also helped Tara Vanderveer over at Stanford with her offense too. So it was always a good time. Mm-hmm.
Outside of basketball, what's something that you're passionate about?
Yeah. Outside of basketball, I'm really passionate about, it's still sports, but sports as a tool for impact and being able to, use sports as a way to make the world a better place put it quite simply. But yeah.
Yeah. Now, you said you always looked up to Magic Johnson for how he was on the court as well as what he did in the community. But now as a professional, who's somebody that is a role model for you as a professional?
Someone that I love as a professional is actually Candace Parker. And I think that she's been able to navigate being both an incredible basketball player, but also like award-winning journalist, really beacon in the community as well, really seamlessly. And so she's definitely someone that I look up to a lot. And
Yeah, it's awesome. So let's dig in a little bit more and kind of go backwards. You said you started playing basketball at a pretty young age, but as you're growing up, was it a goal for you, or was it even really in the cards for you to play at a Division I level and then eventually become a professional athlete?
Yeah, I actually remember being in the fifth grade at a summer camp called I Want to Be a College Basketball Player Camp. So from like the get-go, when I started playing Division I college basketball and professional basketball always was top of mind for me. And I had my little notebook of like what it would take to get there, what college coaches were looking for, body language on the bench. Like I knew about this in the fifth grade. So yeah, definitely was super important to me from the jump. And I think having that vision and that goal at an early age helped me to ultimately know how to get there and understand some of the sacrifices it would take to make it to that level.
Mm-hmm. So then once you make it to a point where recruiting starts to come in, and you said you already have a notebook as a fifth grader, how did that notebook evolve as you become a high school athlete that now has to talk to coaches and navigate a personal life and, you know, try to still be a regular teenager, but you're a high level athlete at the same time. So how did that, your notebook of all these notes start to kind of evolve as you're working through this recruiting process?
Yeah, the recruiting process felt a little bit overwhelming, to be honest, because you get, 50 letters, all these letters that are coming in, and it's really exciting. It also can felt a little bit like overwhelming to have to fill out all of these questionnaires. And like, candidly, I didn't even fill them all out, which was probably a miss on my end. But it did feel, I felt like I, even though I knew what I needed to do on the court, sometimes the stuff off the court felt a little bit daunting and stressful. But my dad was really great. He really helped me to navigate the process, make sure that I was really doing the right things I needed to do both in school and on the court. And just having, I think, strong character as a person that also the coaches were looking for too. But yeah, in terms of just kind of navigating those conversations with coaches, that a lot of that was my dad supporting me and being able to kind of understand how this all works. And but it was new for him too, because he'd never been through the process, so it can be a lot.
Yeah. So yeah, it's a lot when you're being bombarded by letters and phone calls and everything else. How did you narrow it down to the schools that you ultimately wanted to go to?
Yeah, I think there's two things in it. It's one, those schools wanting you, but also you feeling like the schools are also a good fit for your personality, your style of play on the court, and then also like your goals from a like career perspective. So for me, in kind of narrowing down the schools I wanted to go to, it was really looking at, okay, where am I going to get to play for incredible coaches? Where can I go and have an impact on the team? Where can I have an incredible educational experience? So, maybe they have a great basketball program, but they don't have the degrees that I want to study, nor is it a school that like has a reputation that I necessarily am looking for. So that kind of helped me to narrow down like the schools that I wanted to really pursue. And ultimately that's kind of what led me to UC Davis and finding that perfect fit for me.
Mm-hmm. So before you narrowed it down to UC Davis and really figured out that that's where you wanted to be, did you take, your allotted recruiting trips and how did those go? And how did UC Davis kind of end up at the top of the list?
Yeah. So I committed early before doing all my official visits, but I did a lot of unofficial visits. And your official visits, I think you can only take in your senior year. It might have changed with recruiting now. But essentially I did unofficial visits of like various schools. So UC Santa Barbara, USF, UNLV, UC Davis, among others. And, which is really a great experience because you get to go and meet the coaching staff. You get to go and experience campus life. I got to go and kind of sit in on some classes as well, which was super helpful. Visit all the practice facilities and the game day facilities, meet some of the girls that were on the different teams. So it was really helpful in getting to kind of get a flavor of the different schools. You asked why I ultimately chose UC Davis. A couple of reasons. I absolutely love the coaching staff at UC Davis. They are so incredible. They really exemplify this notion of like being more than an athlete, being more than your sport, They're absolutely amazing coaches. Like Coach Jennifer Gross at UC Davis has won Big West Coach of the Year 5 years in a row. I don't think she won it last year, but that's okay. She was winning it this year. But super, just incredible coach, winning consistently. But then the type of character and the humans that they are and the way that they loved us and poured into us and helped each woman on our team reach our potential, like, really was unmatched, and the beacon they were in the community. So that was top of mind for me. Also, UC Davis academically is a really, really great school. And it also had a college town feel to it. So it's a small town. There are about 60,000 people in the town. I think 35,000 of those inhabitants are students. So it's fun to be in a place where, you know, you kind of get to run the town a little bit as students.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's pretty cool. And, you know, something that I always love kind of asking people about is that transition from high school to college. Because, you know, no matter what sport you play, you go from normally being a high school all-star. Everyone knows you, you know, and obviously only like, 1% of student athletes from high school become college athletes anyway. So even that, the pool gets even smaller, right? Once you get to a college campus and everyone's an all-star, everyone's good. Mm-hmm. So you go from dominating to, you know, this kind of debilitating, kind of low on the totem pole, have to prove yourself type of a kid. How did you deal with that once you got to a college campus where, like I said, everyone is an all-star, everybody plays in all-star games from their respective mm-hmm. states, and you know they're playing all over the country? How did you deal with that?
Yeah, it was hard at first. I think just kind of understanding, okay, you're not like the big man or big woman on campus, like mm-hmm. you know coming in as a freshman. I had never really lifted weights like the other women on my team. So I was like a lot weaker. And you're just navigating a way faster style of play, more competitive, where everyone is an all-star that you're playing against and with. So I think there was a little bit of an adjustment in understanding my new role. But also, like, I think I was able to buy in pretty quickly to this fact that everyone on the team matters. And being a freshman, like, I can come in, give big energy minutes, be super, super positive, be like the most energetic one, you know, on the bench as well. And in practice, like really give 150%, see it as both a way to like improve my own skills, add value on the court. And then also, I think that mentality helped me to just improve that much faster for, you know, sophomore year when like I'm getting big minutes and junior, senior, super senior year when I'm captaining the team. So I think being able to have a mentality freshman year that, yeah, this is different than what it looked like as a senior on the high school level, but my role is super important here and I can learn a lot of things and buy in a different way than the role I was playing, you know, that senior year of high school.
Yeah. So now on the academic side, that's a big transition as well. You have to, you know, mom and dad aren't waking you up anymore, right? Like that's just how it is for, you know, for most high school kids is you're getting, you know, one of your parents is waking you up, taking you to school, or, you know, one of your friends is there. Now it's you're accountable for all of it, right? So how do you start to transition into being a college student at the same time of still trying to keep up with, you know, these all-stars that you're now playing with?
Yeah, it is very different from high school. I remember my first quarter at UC Davis. I took a class on Hebrew scriptures and they had us write this. It was like a 12-page paper on, like, I don't remember exactly what the topic was, but it was mostly freshmen that were taking this class. And our professor basically had to, everyone turned in the assignment. She basically had us all rewrite it. She's like, you all failed this assignment pretty much. Go and redo it. This is like not the way we do things in college. So luckily we got a second chance, but I remember being like, oh shoot, I really need to study. I need to be very disciplined because I have 3 hours of practice a day, an hour of weights a day. I need to go to the like training room to get my treatment. That's like 5 hours dedicated to basketball on top of your, you know, 5 hours of classes a day. That doesn't leave much time to study, but when you do have those free gaps, even in the training room, whatever it is, like I knew that I needed to be focused and make sure that I was dedicating time to my studies and really being on top of it. So I think it woke me up and made me really self-disciplined, which was a really good thing for me. But yeah, it wasn't natural at first because high school felt pretty easy compared to college.
Yeah. Yeah. How did you balance all that? You just said, you know, you have 5 to 6 hours of basketball, things that you're devoting straight to basketball every single day. And then you have your couple hours of classes. How are you balancing these, you know, this new life as a, you know, 18-year-old?
Yeah. I think the self-discipline was really important. Also having other teammates or friends that were other athletes at school or even non-athletes at UC Davis that were in a similar situation, like that we could kind of support one another. We could also go and study together and make it something like fun, even though it's like I have to go and be in the library for 4 hours after practice. It's like the last thing I want to do because I'm exhausted. When you would put together a little study group, it would make it more of a fun thing and something that is actually like a really cool part of the college experience to get to learn and grow your brain and to do it with friends, like bring snacks into the library or like order late night In-N-Out burger. Probably not great when you have practice the next day, but wonderful for your mental health. I think those kinds of things also were really helpful as well. So I think it was a lot of it was on me, but also like building community and a team around me, both my actual teammates, but also like friends and a support group at UC Davis along the way.
Obviously you're in a leadership role now as a professional, but back then as a college student, were you already thinking about that professional avenue, the corporate professional avenue as a college student?
Candidly, not a bit, but not in the same. I was so focused on basketball and I think being the best that I can be and being great at school and making sure that when I went to class and I was giving my all as well. So I was excellent where I was, but I was very present. And so sometimes it was hard to think outside of school. I always knew that I was passionate about something in international relations and impact. And obviously I loved sport, but when I was in college as a 20-year-old, I didn't know that I would want to be head of strategy at an impact focused sports agency and like do sports diplomacy and change the world through sport. Like that wasn't necessarily top of mind for me. I just was really focused on being very present. And I did have really incredible career counselors that, you know, when I would say something that like wasn't on brand for me as a person, my career counselor would say, that doesn't make sense for you. I think she helped provide some guidance, but yeah, I didn't have a very clear vision at 20. That didn't come until I was actually playing professionally in Switzerland when I really got more clear vision for life after basketball.
Mm-hmm. Now you said as a fifth grader, you had that notebook and obviously that notebook transitions when you become a college athlete. Does it change to wanting to be a professional athlete? Was that on, you know, your vision board or was that something that kind of came to fruition as you were playing?
Yeah, being a professional was always something that I wanted to do. I'd have been a dream since I was 10. Also in the notebook, you know, I think when I got to college, I had my third knee surgery. Actually, by the time I entered my super senior fifth year, I was 3 surgeries in. So I was a bit discouraged on the possibility of playing professionally just because I didn't know if my body could hold up or if it was the smart thing to do. But actually when I got to the end of my senior year, I felt great. I was playing really well and it just didn't feel like that was the time to be done. And so I was ready to go and shoot my shot to play professionally. So I think I definitely always wanted to do it. And even in college, I wanted to do it. I just had a little bit of a setback after all the knee surgeries, but praise the Lord, I was able to go and play and make it work.
Yeah. So now once you start to play professionally, that's another leap, right? Another growth period for you. What was that like, especially because you're not playing here in the States, you're playing overseas. So what was that growth period like for you?
Yeah, it was really fun actually. And a bit of a challenge at the same time. I played professionally in Switzerland, in a city of Lausanne. And so in Lausanne, first of all, the language they speak there is French. It's a French-speaking region of Switzerland. So I was navigating a new language, also culturally, their style of basketball is like quite different. America, we're a little bit more one-on-one, a little bit flashier, take someone off the dribble to the rack. And in Switzerland, it's a little bit more like fundamental pass first. We also talk a lot more in the US, like the style of play is like when you're in help side on defense, you're talking the whole time. In Switzerland, like I remember my first practice, I looked very weird. I was the only one talking the entire practice. Everyone else was like kind of silent. So there were these kinds of things. And then the coaching style is also like quite a bit different. And then lastly, my role was very different. When I came into Switzerland, the expectation was that I was dropping 20 a game with 10 assists and 10 rebounds. And I was playing point guard. And in college, I was more of a like defensive specialist, pass first point guard, captain on the team, you know, energy girl. I wasn't expected to score 20 points a game. That wasn't my role. So it was a little bit different in that regard too. It was also really fun, honestly, because you could shoot a bunch of shots and like, I felt like Kobe out there. So I really liked that too. But yeah, it was definitely a different thing to navigate a lot of various factors I just mentioned.
Mm-hmm. So then is at this point in your career, are you starting to think about life after basketball?
Yeah. So Switzerland was the most incredible place to be, especially Lausanne. I didn't know it at the time, but this city is where the International Olympic Committee is headquartered, which is the biggest governing body for sports. The IOC, basically they put on all of the Olympic different Olympics that we see in the world. So Paris 2024 coming up, Milano Cortina, which is the Winter Olympics, and then LA 28, which will be hosted again in Los Angeles. And to get to be in this city, where the most influential sporting organization in the world is, that really, I also think, serves as a beacon of like hope and connection. It's this beautiful movement where people from all around the world can come together. It was so cool to think about how can I combine my passion for sports, international relations, and impact. And so getting to be in this city was really, really inspiring and helped me to think about, okay, what do I need to do to be able to achieve my ultimate goal, which was combining sports and impact? So it kind of served as a catalyst for me thinking about my next moves.
Yeah. How was that transition then after sports? Most people are, you know, it's hard. You know, it's very hard for people to transition of not being an athlete. How did you handle it?
Yeah, it was really hard. But I think what really helped me was finding this passion outside of, you know, being on the court, and I was able to dedicate all of that focus and that discipline and all those skills I learned from basketball into now my second career. So I was like, I know what I need to do to become a successful person in the sports industry and to really navigate this space. I want to get a master's degree. I want to be bilingual. I want to speak French. I kind of formulated a new game plan for myself and was able to just dive into that 110%. And that same passion that I had for basketball, I was able to kind of channel into this new career. So I think it really helped. It still was hard because there's that side of getting to go to practice every day with your teammates or something so special about being on the court that, you know, I think sometimes isn't necessarily always there on the corporate side of things. It is, but it's a little bit different. But yeah, I think having a new passion allowed me to made the transition a lot easier.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, you kind of dove headfirst, right? Right into the corporate side of things and made that transition. And, what a lot of athletes do is they start to attack the corporate side of things the same way that they attack when they're on the playing field. Right. So, and that's what it seems like you did. You know, you started to work internationally. You've done a good amount of things to get to where you are now. Now you're at 17 Sport. Talk about 17 Sport a little bit. Give us a little in and out of who 17 Sport is and what you guys do.
Yeah. So 17 Sport is an impact focused sports company or sports agency. Essentially, we work with the top leagues, teams, athletes, and brands who sponsor sports in the world. And we're helping these different teams and leagues and brands to use their platform to make the world a better place, solving global challenges, which also leads to better brand building and financial returns. So as an example, we work with Adidas, particularly on their Breaking Barriers program, which is their gender equity program. And we've helped them to craft a strategy to get 50,000 more girls to play sports over the next 5 years across Europe, to also equip 100 champions across Europe as well, to be able to essentially elevate the ecosystem surrounding women and girls playing sports, and to build the capacity of that ecosystem to better serve women and girls in sports. We've also launched an incubator for businesses that are looking to tackle some of the challenges to getting girls and women to play sports. We have an online training program for coaches and educators and business professionals working in women in sports. So lots of great resources and work that we've done with Adidas as a client. We've worked with the NFL. We also represent professional purpose-driven athletes like Benoit Badashiel, who's a football player for Chelsea FC, Ezra Freck, who does track for Team USA. He's a world champion for high jump. Total World Changer has his own nonprofit called Angel City Sports. So that's a little bit of the, and actually, lastly, we also work with the International Olympic Committee as well, which mm-hmm. is very full circle for me, having been in Lausanne, and really praying and wanting to work at that organization one day, getting to now work alongside them in a consulting capacity has been really magical. So it's a little bit about our company.
So like you said, a lot of it came full circle for you. You know, went from wanting to be, you know, a Division I basketball player to being a professional to now working and having such an impact on the sport and, you know, basically all sports, but directly on basketball, you've had a huge impact. And you talk about that a lot, of that being your passion of, you know, gender equality, right? And making sure that more girls like you, when you were growing up, have more opportunities to do some of these things that, you know, you had the chance to do with going to camp and everything like that. What's it mean to you that now you can give back to the sport that gave so much to you?
Yeah, it's really incredible. And it's changed so much from when I was growing up, the way that we view women's sports, the way that the WNBA is marketed, shown on television, talked about. It's incredible. I remember as a kid being so passionate about like making sure that if we had a high school basketball game, we always played before the guys and we were better than the guys' team. Like we had, you know, we got second in CIF. We were really ranked number 3 in the county. Like we had a really, really good team. Yet there would still be more people that would go and watch the boys, which it should be equal. We should watch both the teams, right? I'm not saying don't go to the boys game because I love our boys team. But it really kind of ignited this sense of justice in me and frustration because we were mm-hmm. so good and I wanted our student body to see that. So we would really, you know, go and talk to our other students, make sure they were getting out. So already was kind of passionate about that, like advocacy piece and getting other people inspired about just our high school team as a young girl. It's so, so incredible to get to be working in this space. You know, I've done work with UNESCO, which is the United Nations offices in Paris as well, on sports diplomacy and gender equity, projects with Adidas around gender equity, like I mentioned to you, and then with 17 Sport on the whole as well, we do a lot in this space. It's really, really incredible to get to give back and to get to be a part of that too. And women's sports are just on an upward trajectory, growing so, so much each year. But yeah, it's really exciting.
Yeah. And you've seen this year, I think it was the US Open doing, you know, the 50th anniversary with Billie Jean King of, you know, men and women being paid equally. Right. And you're seeing a lot more, like you said, upward trajectory with the WNBA and, you know, in doing research on you, I saw that you had a chance to, you know, be a part of, you know, WNBA All-Star Week as well as NBA All-Star Week. And, you know, I saw the clip of you playing against Tom Holland and things like that too. So you've done some really cool things. What were some of your favorite projects that you've got to work on? I know you mentioned Adidas and some of the others, but what were some of your favorite projects that you got to work on?
Yeah. Another project that I'm a part of, an organization that I really love, is called the Hoop Bus. It's an incredible nonprofit, was launched in 2020, essentially using basketball to help uplift and serve communities around the world. So with the Hoop Bus, we've gotten to do some really cool things around the NBA All-Star Weekend and WNBA All-Star Weekend, whether that is putting on camps for women and girls alongside Dick's Sporting Goods, or doing an activation with Gatorade where we have a 3-on-3 tournament with kids in Salt Lake City, and then having Paul George kind of judge the dunk competition as part of that, celebrity dunk competition as part of that. So it's been really incredible to get to actually play my sport and get to be a part of that and serve kind of behind the scenes with the Hoop Bus team a little bit in leaving that positive and lasting legacy in the community. So I've really loved that. And that particular, that clip where I was playing against Tom Holland, Spider-Man, it was a really cool day. Actually, Zendaya, who you might know is big time actress, incredible woman. She's actually from Oakland. And she approached the Hoop Bus to help her build a court in Oakland, which is her hometown and city, alongside Project Backboard, which is another really cool nonprofit, and then 100 Black Men, which is another amazing nonprofit as well. It's national. So we put on an event there, which culminated in an all-star celebrity game, as well as some dunk competitions. And yeah, but she did some incredible work there. She refurbished this court. She created an entire new water system for the school that was attached there. She also helped to renovate the theater as well and just put on this incredible day for the community. So Zendaya and Tom Holland are my favorite celebrity couple. So down to earth, so cool. I'm a little bit sad that I crossed up Tom Holland and then missed my layup twice. Two layups I missed after getting around them quickly. But yeah, no, it was a great day.
Yeah. And it looked like a ton of fun. It looks like you get to have a ton of fun in your job and travel a ton. You know, we're somewhere that you've been that you always wanted to go and make a huge impact. That was really fun for you.
Yeah. A place that I absolutely loved visiting was Togo. So Togo is a small West African country. And, one of my good friends, John Luke, has a nonprofit called Miledu, which means we are together in the Togolese dialect. So he invited me out there. I was originally there for a UNESCO United Nations trip. Then I got to stay on with him for a week and we went all around Togo. He has, I think 8 different cities that he has run different programs. Basically they're like basketball programs for youth. They have after school programs. He's built educational centers in these different cities and really incredible courts that are powered by solar. So I got to go through with him and we did some basketball camps and clinics, got to hang out with these amazing women and girls and boys as well, play basketball with them and yeah, just get to encourage one another. It was really, really, really cool and had a huge impact on me. Just seeing the beauty of how global this game is and how much of a connector it is and how the same joy that I experienced playing basketball in San Francisco, I'm experiencing, you know, in Kuve in Togo. You know, it's very transferable and such a connection point.
Yeah. So we started off this conversation talking about role models and you talked about, you know, Magic Johnson and a couple other people that are that were your role models growing up. Now I feel like you're in that role as a role model and there's a good amount of women and girls that probably can look to you for that same type of inspiration. How does it feel to know that you've gone from, you know, that fifth grade girl playing basketball to now being in this position where you are a role model? And how do you take on that position?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is. I think it's quite humbling and also really cool and kind of a sacred thing to know that I have the ability to impact others and the next generation and really making sure that I use that responsibility in the right way. Because people are looking up to me and to you, Ryan, whether we even realize it or not, but being able to make sure that my character shines through. I think it's John Wooden. I'm going to blank on this quote, but he says, be more concerned about your character than your reputation, because your character is who you really are. Your reputation is who people think you are. So I think making sure that my character is really at its core, like on point. And for me, there's a humility in that too. It comes down to my faith. I'm a Christian. And so for me, a lot of that is making sure that I'm like loving people well, Because that's kind of like my mission is to like love God and love people. And so I think if that's on point and like my character's in the right place, it allows me to the things that I do externally, like just flow naturally. I don't have to like try and put it on or be someone that I'm not, but I'm just being fully me. And I think that in being fully me, it's easier to kind of reflect that light in the way that I want to. But then I think there is an intentionality in giving back as well and making sure that I am, you know, invested in the lives of the next generation, whether that is through like the hoop bus or my work on the day to day, or just going down to the park and like giving encouraging words to other kids who are shooting around with me. So I think it can happen like organically and then also like with more intentionality.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, do you, you know, before we get into another piece, do you still play a little bit?
I do. Yeah. I play at the Olympic Club, which is a club in San Francisco, and it's amazing. It's a lot of former Division I or professional basketball players who are a part of the club. And so we have really competitive, league games and open gyms, probably too competitive at this point, but still really, really fun. I also do a lot with a hoop bus. So we do a lot of different like celebrity games or, 3-on-3 tournaments. I played in the Venice Ball Women's League this past summer, which is a street basketball league on the beach in Los Angeles, which was founded by a good friend of mine, Nico Ansem. And then, yeah, some trips, whether it's like to Togo, Ivory Coast, hopefully going to Paris in January for the NBA Paris game happening there, might do some stuff as well there. So, yeah, I still play a lot, which is fun.
Yeah, that's pretty cool that you get to mix, you know, all your passions into one. Brianna, this was an awesome conversation. I'm really glad that, you know, we stayed connected, one, but two, that you could come on here and kind of share your path. And like I said, you know, as we've learned throughout this entire conversation, you've been part of a good amount of organizations. Before I let you go, I kind of want to let you, you know, shout out some of these different projects that you guys either have coming up or, you know, some of these organizations that you're a part of.
Yeah. So I would love to use that to just kind of highlight some of my favorite organizations. So I mentioned the Hoop Bus and Venice Ball, which are two. Hoop Bus is the nonprofit that is, it's literally a school bus with a hoop attached to the front of it that goes around to different nonprofits or community organizations like Boys and Girls Club to kind of give a boost and amplify the activities of those nonprofits, provide financial support and resources, put on clinics and kind of inspire that next generation. I also really love Miledu LYSD, which is an incredible nonprofit out of Ivory Coast and Togo, doing work with kids in that, like across the globe in that capacity. Who are some other organizations I can shout out that I love? Yeah, maybe I'll kind of leave it to that. Actually, just those two, because those are two of my favorite. But yeah, there's another one Lexi Mickens is running called Run It Back, which is another really cool nonprofit using basketball in an international capacity. They host different runs. They have a mentorship component attached to that as well. So yeah, these are some community organizations that I support, and I love the work that they're doing. Yeah, so I'll leave it at that.
Yeah,
just want to hype up the cool. other people.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Now, the last thing is, before we let you go, we always like to have a piece of advice, and I know we've been pretty inspirational throughout this entire conversation. But what's a piece of advice, either something that, you know, you had in your notebook or something that a coach taught you or something that you just learned from experience, right? A lot of the things that people don't realize is in sports, a lot of it is still trial by fire. You may have the accolades and the degrees and all the experience, but a lot of it is still trial by fire. So, you know, what's a piece of advice that we can pass on to that next generation?
Mm-hmm. I think I would say, don't be afraid to shoot your shot, like shoot with confidence. And don't be afraid to fail either. Like, I think as athletes, we are constantly taking an L, meaning like even in practice, if you lose a drill, okay, you got to go run a suicide. But I think that builds a resilience in us and a little bit of a, like an understanding that failure is actually part of the journey and you fail in order to be better and to achieve. And Michael Jordan says you miss 100% of the shots you never take. Right. But I think there's something to that, right? Like never lose that confidence in yourself, continue to, just like step up to the plate. Don't be afraid, because I think there are yeah, you just have so much potential, and don't let anyone else ever bring you down or tell you you're not good enough. Like, believe in yourself and know that you can do it. You're made for greatness. You can do it if you have that confidence and faith in yourself.
Awesome. Well, Brianna, like I said, this has been a great conversation. Like I said, I'm glad that we stayed connected. It's awesome watching you, you know, grow tremendously and all the different things that you're part of. Before I let you go, do you have anything else, any other shout outs you want to give or let people know where they can either find you or find 17 Sport?
Yeah. Okay. Two shout outs. One, definitely you can find me, would love to connect, on Instagram or LinkedIn. My Instagram is Brianna_Salvatore_Dueck. LinkedIn is my name, Brianna Salvatore Dueck. And then the second shout out, Ryan, is for you. Thank you so much for having me on the show. Also, just you using your voice to encourage the next generation, all the work that you're doing with, you know, just across your different functional job areas is really inspiring and really encouraging. And I love to see you giving back. Yeah, and you're an incredible leader. So keep shining your light, keep doing your thing. It's awesome. And we need more of it.
Oh, thank you. Appreciate that. So with that, I'm going to let you go. And I can see the California sun kind of shining through your window there. So I'm going to let you go. Enjoy the rest of your day. I'm sure you have tons and tons of things to get going. I think it's, what is it? Like, not even noon there yet. So let you get throughout the rest of your day. But I really appreciate it. Definitely stay in contact. If there's ever anything, like I told you when we first met, you know, certainly reach out.
Will do. Awesome. Thank you, Ryan. I'll talk to you soon.
Thank you for listening to the Athletes to Athletes podcast. Make sure you hit the like and subscribe button so you don't miss when another episode drops. Again, we appreciate you listening, and we'll see you again next time.